Hi, welcome to our podcast, Those Twins Who Knit. My name is Rachel.
And I'm Jessica.
And for those who are new here, this is our space where we talk about all the things that we've been knitting recently. And if you were with us for our last podcast, it has been about 4 weeks. So we've got lots of knitting done.
Yeah, lots to talk about. And yeah, this is the weekend of Rhinebeck. We're obviously not there, but we've been watching a lot of content this weekend, just living vicariously through the people who are there. So if you're at any wool festivals this weekend, just know we're super jealous. And have definitely been keeping an eye on everything that's going on, hoping that maybe next year we'll have a chance to come and join everyone. Maybe.
Yeah. I know, it was fun.
Yeah.
But we've got lots of knitting done, so.
Yeah, you know.
Do you want to talk about what you're wearing?
Sure. This was one of my main whips in our last podcast, so I'm not going to go into too much detail. I feel like I talked about it a lot in the last one, so if you want to know any of the major details or things that I ran into, definitely check that one out. I think since then and now, all I had to do really was just finish one of the sleeves. I feel like I've done.
Yeah, you were pretty far last time.
Far? I don't remember which sleeve it was, if it was one or the other, but so not a ton of progress since the last time around, but I did finish it and block it, and so now I get to wear it and everything. And here, let me undo it so you can see the bottom. I kind of like it tucked in, but it's a good length where you can kind of wear it either way. It is made with tin silk mohair and tin pure gint, both by Sanda's Garn. And I made the smallest size and used up every last little bit. Like, I had inches left over in some of the yarn. So if you're making it and your gauge is slightly off, you might order a little bit extra just to be safe, because I was playing some serious yarn chicken, but it did work out. I did finish it with just enough yarn. And honestly, the sleeves hit right at my thumb, so worst case, I probably could have shortened it just a little bit.
I love the length.
Yeah, oh, I'm super happy with it. I'm just saying, if I had run out, I probably would have been okay. but I was, I got my swatch out and everything. I was so prepared to have to undo my swatch to use, every last little inch of yarn.
No.
It was cutting it so close. But yeah, it's a pattern by Lee Knit on Instagram and Ravelry called the Portion Sweater. And I'm super happy with it. I really like it.
I love that design.
Yeah.
It is beautiful.
Yeah. It is a little toasty here. It looks like fall outside, but it's not quite fall weather.
It's still in the 70s. It's fall this morning.
Yeah.
But now that it's getting to be mid-afternoon, it's
it's getting a little, after this,
not really sweater weather.
Yeah. At least not mohair sweater. It's maybe a fingering weight sweater weather.
Yeah. Or t-shirt with a light cardigan or something.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But we decided to wear our finished optics instead.
Which
we suffer. Yes, so this is one of my finished objects too. This was a work in progress in the last episode. So this is the Stripe Pipe sweater by Veronica Lindberg, who goes by
Kukavakika, maybe?
She has a great YouTube channel on here that I really like watching. Yes, that sounds right. Something similar to that.
Okay.
Yes, but Veronica Lindberg. So this is the Stripe Pipe sweater. And this was somewhat of a stash project because 4 of the 6 colors that are used on this I already had. So I used both Knitting for Olives Merino and Sanda's Garn Sunday. So my colors are Knitting for Olive Camel, Navy, Raccoon, which this has 3 stripes. It's 3, 3, 3, but I just tucked it in so you cannot see it. But there's 3. So Raccoon, and then Dark Cognac, and then the base color is Sanda's Garn Almond, and the blue is a Sanda's Garn Sunday Petite Knit color. Something like baby blue eyes or something like that. I threw the label away almost immediately when I got home, so but it's something like that. And it has these really cute details where when you bind off, it's got a contrast color in just the last 2 rows, which will become a theme because I have that again later on. But yeah, I really liked that I got to use a little bit of stash. It was super quick. I think I finished this in almost 2 weeks, or maybe a little over 2 weeks. And last episode or last podcast, I had said that as I was doing this, I thought that this would be a really good beginner sweater pattern. And I'm gonna stand by that. I really think that it was pretty simple because the construction is like basically knitting a rectangle and stockinette for the back and then pick up stitches. So, I mean, that's a technique you'd have to learn if you're not familiar, but it's not hard. Pick up stitches and knit the collar, then connect them and knit down. The pattern did have decreases in the body. I did not do those. I don't regret my choice. I thought that that was fine. And then you pick up stitches for the sleeves and just do some decreases through the sleeves. She did call for this part, like the ribbing part, to be a little bit longer. And for some reason, when I was knitting it, I just wasn't liking the look of that longer cuff. So I did shorten it by about half an inch, which when it's at my sides, it lays perfectly, but you can tell when I lift my arms, it is a little bit short. So I don't know. I don't really regret my decision, but that was a modification. So if you're like, oh, that looks short, yours does not have to be that way. I went up a needle size in the body. She recommended going down a significant amount for the ribbing on both the collar and the cuffs, and I only went down one needle size. I think it jumped from like a US size 6 to a US 2.5, and that would be a huge needle difference, I thought, for what it was asking, so I just went down one size, but I used a 7 instead of a 6. Anyway, so I did not go down as much in gauge as she recommended for these two parts, the ribbing. But those are all the, I think, details on this sweater. And I really like it. I'm happy with how it turned out.
Yep. So, and yeah, thanks for everyone who let us know your opinion on carrying the yarn in stripes. I feel like most people were on your side in that you should cut the yarn for these sorts of stripes. But there were a few people.
I feel like the opinion was, if you want to do it right, you should cut them and weave them in, which is what I did.
Yeah.
But the people who said that they carried it or would carry, they seemed pretty confident that it would be fine without.
As long as your tension was correct, they seemed confident.
Yeah,
so I appreciate that.
So you do you. I did weave it in. I guess I should go back and say that because, so I said I knitted this in like 2 weeks, which is true. It did take me almost that same amount of time to motivate myself to weave in the ends. I would literally do like two ends and then be like, oh, woe is me, I cannot go on. And then I wanted to weave in the ends before I blocked it. So that took forever. And then as I was doing that, I got nervous about blocking it. I was like, oh my gosh, why didn't I swatch with these colors? Like I only swatched with the body color. And so I was like, what if these colors bleed? And I was really only nervous about the navy for some reason. So I did a second swatch of just the almond with the navy to make sure that it wouldn't bleed. It did not. So when I did have one time where knitting for all of their black, but I think it was a different base.
The licorice.
Yes.
Yeah.
That one did bleed one time on me. So, but I think it was their, Pure Silk.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, their silk base, that bled. So I swatched with this one. It worked out fine. So then I finally got to block this. So yeah, I did knit this in like 2 weeks, but I guess I should say it took longer than 2 weeks to actually finish if you count it. I don't...
To me, when you're done knitting it...
Is that when you're done or is it when it's like blocked and ready to wear that it's done?
I don't know. I wouldn't wear it before it's blocked, so I guess it's not really done until...
Well, I had already steamed this a lot because I was nervous the collar was still too tight, so I had steamed it before. So it wasn't looking horrible before blocking, but yeah, it did take a while to weave in those ends, I'm not going to lie.
Honestly, I'd probably do that though. After seeing yours, like it probably is the right way to do it.
Yeah, but you do you.
Yeah.
It worked out. Okay, so that's one of my finished objects.
I have two more.
Okay, yeah, you go first.
The other one is one that I was also working on in the last podcast. Actually, all three of my finished objects are. But this is my Billy cardigan by Sari Nordland. I'll hold it up a little bit.
So wait, show the back so that you can see the...
Oh, that's a good idea.
The cables are so beautiful.
Yeah, it's got a beautiful like honeycomb cable in the back. And actually, I'll try to hold up the yoke so you can see the.
Oh, sorry.
there's a ton of cables across it. So yeah, it's just super textured. And anywhere where there's not cabling, there's seed stitch. So just all over texture. And I did use Blue Sky Fibers wool stock in the color Driftwood. And I used 450 grams. And I used up almost every little bit of it. It wasn't quite as bad as this one as far as yarn checking goes, but like I used up quite a bit. Like I don't have enough that I would really like save for a project or anything like that. But no, this was just such a joy to knit on. The only thing that I modified really, and it wasn't even a modification because she said you could do this in the pattern, was she gave like a recommended length as far as like how long to make it. But then she said that you can knit it to whatever length is your preference, and so I did shorten it by 2 inches, and it did grow quite a bit in walking, so were I to do this again, I would probably shorten it by another inch. But that was my only modification, and it was really a joy to test knit. I mean, she was very quick to respond to any questions or anything, and there was no major alterations or issues that I ran into or anything like that, so honestly, it made me want to make the Billy pullover, if anything.
I do want to knit that cardigan.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't think I have anything else to say about it. It was such a fun cardigan. I really enjoyed it. And I do have some finished object pictures of me wearing it, so we'll try to add that in.
Yeah.
Just so you can see what it looks like on.
I'm sorry, my cat walked into the room, so if you're like, what is she looking at? I'm just like watching my cat walking around.
But yeah, you have another finished object.
Yeah, I have another finished object. So, and this one was not a whip last time. It was, like, she just came out of nowhere. So, this is my clay sweater. Or is it clay? I think she called it sweater, not pullover. Clay sweater from
Ozenit. It'll be in the comments.
Yes, I'm pretty confident that's right. I should know this because I am a test knitter for it. So, Haley Schmedley of Ozeta, she did a test call in her newsletter, which I'm subscribed to, and it got me. I signed up. So this is the test knit that we did, and it's actually not due till this Wednesday, the 25th, so I was ahead of schedule. But it's got this really beautiful, it focused for a second. There we go. just kind of pattern of alternating stockinette and then garter and just knits and purl rows that creates this all over texture throughout the entire thing. It carries on to the sleeves. And then I really liked that she did this detail. I didn't even see this when she did the test call. So then as I was knitting it, I was like, oh, that's genius. To hide the, how do I describe this? Like when you're switching between the knit purl or the knit rows and the purl rows, she does this like faux seam situation on the side so that way it really looks seamless and you can't tell where the rows are transitioning. So I thought that was a really smart design element that she added. So I knitted the smallest size, and she recommended a DK weight from Wool Dreamers, which I would have really liked to use because I like Wool Dreamers yarn. But I have been having trouble getting gauge with the DK yarn. Like this happened on the last test knit that I did too. The gauge was 18 stitches for a DK on size US 8. I just was not going to get gauge on that. So I used and I have a whole extra skein, that's how I'm able to hold this. I don't know what I'm going to do with it. I used the Fiber Co. Cumbria worsted. If this looks familiar, it's because I bought the fingering version for the Nord pullover, and then I went and bought the exact same color. But, and then I paired it with a Knitting for Olive mohair. So I'm really convinced that even though this is worsted, it's a pretty light worsted, because then with a mohair, I think I got a true worsted weight. And I thought they paired really nicely together. This is Knitting for Olive off-white, which I have not seen them have for a while now, I don't think. I could be wrong. I feel like maybe they replaced that with cream.
Yeah.
This has been in my stash for, well, this one I bought. This has been in my stash for so long, I do not even remember what I bought it for. And this is all I have left now, so I was very happy that I got to use some of that up. And What else can I say about it?
Oh, Tuff did a great job.
Do you want credit?
Sure.
We had a hair appointment, and Jessica did not bring her knitting
or a book or anything. I really don't know what
I was doing. I came prepared, so she helped me with one of the cups.
Yeah, I did one of the cups while I was waiting for her to finish up, and then I could get my hair
done. It does look very nice.
Yeah. I don't even know if it was this one or not, but one of them. So,
yeah. Oh, here's what else. I knew there was something else I needed to share about this.
Have you weaved in the ends?
I thought I had, but I must have missed.
Oh no.
Nobody saw. Okay, here's what I needed to share. So I said the stitch gauge was 18 stitches. I don't remember what the row gauge was, but what I do remember is that I learned that my row gauge was a little bit longer than hers, which in the body was not so much of an issue. She had more of these like repeats than I ended up with. I think that my collar might have ended up a tiny bit bigger because of that, but then when it came to the sleeves, I didn't have, like, I got the length before the amount of decreases. That was totally my fault because I did not do a good job of checking my row gauge. I feel like in most patterns it doesn't affect too much other than maybe yardage. And so I guess just my advice, if you're interested in this design, is that the row gauge does matter a little bit. It wasn't a huge deal. I just put an extra decrease into the cuff and like it was fine. But yeah, definitely check your row gauge when you're swatching for this because I did not, and that was my fault. And like I said, it wasn't like a major thing throughout, but just something to be a little bit aware of for this one. So that is my only other finished object, but two sweaters in a month is enough.
Yep.
So
I have one more finished object while we're still in this category, and that is these just kind of like waffle textured socks. I don't know that it's
good. Oh, it focused for a minute.
Oh, here. Well, hopefully you got that. it's using the Leek colorway in the Natural Sock Base by Coast to Coast Yarn. And if you joined us for our last episode, you'll know that I was making the season socks originally with this yarn. Which also had a kind of a waffly texture, but that texture used a lot of slip stitches in order to get that texture. And while it was super cute in the leg and I was just absolutely obsessed with it, when it came to the foot, the stockinette on the bottom of the foot was getting a lot longer than the slip stitch pattern.
It was like bowing up at the top. Kind of.
Yeah, like, see how that's like a normal sock shape? It was like where they had made like either that pattern or like similar pattern, and some people said that that blocked out and some people said that it didn't, and the folks who were saying it didn't were making me nervous because even though when I was wearing it, like, I tried the socks on and it looked fine on my foot, I don't know, I wanted them to lay cute in my little sock drawer, and I just knew that if they looked like clown socks, like, I wasn't gonna be as happy with them. But I still really liked the waffle texture that it was producing. Like, it just felt very, like, cozy and fall-like. So I just did, like, a vanilla sock pattern with, like, 64 stitches around, starting from the cuff and then working down. But instead of the pattern that was being used in the Seasons cardigan, I just did, like, knit two rows and then do two rows of knit two, purl two. And so it created kind of a waffly texture. It's definitely, like, a bigger texture than the Seasons cardigan. But they're still cozy and have fall vibes, and they lay like normal socks. So I'm happy with them. And yeah, I did have quite a bit of yarn left over from this. Like, it didn't use up, I probably have like a good 40 grams left over, so I'm gonna hold on to it, and I'm hoping I can use the Leek as some more like accents for future socks, you know.
Well, or I think I've got a little bit, not enough for a pair of socks, but if you had other ideas, you could always have my stash.
Oh yeah, that would work. So I don't know, I'll probably take a break from the Leek, but I have a little bit left over, so maybe it'll make another appearance one day. But I think that's it for me as far as finished objects go.
Wait, I have to do an increase. Oh,
Okay, well, I have three whips, so I can talk about one of mine.
Oh, wait. But mine is related because it is also socks.
Oh, okay.
So, and then you have three whips?
Yeah.
Okay.
Which is so
weird. I've only got two.
I normally don't have that many.
So, I have finished one. Let's see if we can get her beautiful texture to show up. One of two, so my other one is on the needles. And the ballad socks by Sari Nordlund. And I took maybe some inspiration from this. And then also I saw when I was, it was the Daily Socks by Summer Lee. She did something similar on the cuff of that sock. I ended up not finishing that project, but I took inspiration from it. So here it is again. I just really like that look.
It's
I think
cute.
That the little tiny contrast, I'll probably do that quite a bit because I've got, I don't know, just lots of yarns that I think would look cute together for this. But this is, like I said, the Ballad Socks by Sari Nordlund. And it is in, is this Unexpected Friendship from Coast to Coast from her Book Trope collection. We loved that collection. Mm-hmm. So, and then I really, really liked this contrast color, not only because it looked really good with the speckles. Let me do that again, see if it will. It's got these really subtle little flecks of like brown and orange and green. But I really liked, the contrast color, I guess I should say, is Biscuits from Coast to Coast, because I did that color in my Poet socks earlier this year. And the Poet socks, oh my gosh, I'm asking my camera to focus a lot. The Poet socks have this like larger motif pattern, and then Ballad takes that same motif but shrinks it down. And so they're like little sister socks. They just look good together. And so I liked having that contrast color. So I've got the other one on the needles. I am not crazy about Magic Loop for sock, but I think that this pattern, Magic Loop, is the best way to do it. Because sometimes you're doing yarn overs and then the yarn overs will end at the end of a needle if you're doing double pointed needles. So that's all I guess I really have to contribute about this, but I just thought while you were talking about socks that I would sneak this one in. So, and these ones aren't really part of this, but I just thought they looked so cute together. So that is one of my works in progress right now. Sorry, you can keep going.
No, those are so cute.
I know, I really like them. And I think just because it's Socktober, I was like, I want to finish a pair of socks this month so bad. So I am going to try to finish those before the end of the month.
Yum.
So.
Well, I will talk about next the one, well, I think it's the one whip that I talked about in last month's podcast. I think at the time
it was acquisition.
I don't think I had. I think I started pretty shortly after we filmed that, and that is my Holly sweater by Knitting for Olive.
I love it so much.
I finished the body and obviously the yoke here. Let me see if I can get it to show you some of the details a little bit. I'm making the second size, and for some reason on the needle it looked massive, but then when I hold it up it doesn't.
I don't think it will be too big.
No, I don't think so. I hope it grows a little bit when blocking, and I imagine it would. So yeah, I just bind off. this morning for the body, and then I need to start the sleeves, but I don't think those will take too long. I will say, I did not enjoy working on this yoke at all. I don't love doing three-colored color work. Like, normally, if it's two colors, that's fine. I can do that forever, like, all day, every day. But when you get three colors in the mix, it just starts to get kind of messy, especially because with this pattern, for all of it, I was holding a fingering Knitting for Olive Merino with the Knitting for Olive strand of Silk Mohair. And so when you get three colors going, it's actually six balls of yarn. And it was just kind of messy. And normally when I do color work, I try to be particular with myself, and I try to keep like the dominant color where, usually I like to make the contrast color the dominant color. So I would make like green the dominant color when you're doing color work. You know, that's the one that you always keep on top of the other one when you're doing a row of stranded knitting. But with three, I was kind of like, eh, like, whatever I needed to do in order to keep the balls of yarn organized is what I did. Because otherwise it was just too much. And then on top of that, baubles are just not my favorite thing to
do. I don't enjoy baubles either. No. I will do them. But...
So having three colors plus baubles, it was just kind of...
unpleasant.
It was kind of unpleasant. I think it's going to be worth it. I'm excited. Like, I think it's going to be a really cute sweater. I'm looking forward to wearing it this Christmas season. And like, I don't know. I think every knitter has those dreams where they're like, at a Christmas party and someone's like, oh, I love your sweater, and you get to be like, thanks, I made it. So like, that's the dream that I have for this sweater, and I think we'll get there. But if you don't love three color work, or you haven't done it before, maybe just like take my warning.
Maybe like don't start this as your first color work project.
Yeah, it wasn't the easiest or most fun to do, but thankfully, I mean, it's not that many rows, so in the grand scheme of things,
push through.
It's not that bad, but yeah, I literally had to like power through the yoke because I was like, if I put this down, I'm not gonna pick it up again.
I have aspirations after I finish the project I'm working on now on these socks of knitting my. I'm gonna do the festive yoke pullover for my Christmas sweater, but. We haven't even started, so...
Yeah, you'll get there.
Yeah, you're gonna beat me, but it's okay.
That's okay.
Alright. I don't have any other finished objects. Well, I guess works in progress. So, this is the only one I have left, but you have the same one, so should we talk about it together?
Yeah, I'll hold mine up if you want to talk about it.
Yes. So, we are both knitting the Eva cardigan by Petite Knit. This is what mine looks like. Oh, we're actually closer. We're not that far. I thought you were way ahead of me. So
I don't think so.
Yeah.
Maybe by a little tiny bit, but not
significantly. Okay, cool. I feel like I've seen a lot of people starting on this. It has a very interesting construction. I did not, I guess, expect you. Mine's like in mid row, so I'm sorry if this looks weird. You cast on and you do increases along the side. On here, like along these edges, and then you cut it pretty quickly. You pick up stitches and knit basically like a straight rectangle. Then you take the row that you had and connect them, and you like knit all the way across, and then do your...
picking up stitches in between.
Yes, picking up stitches along that edge that you knitted, like that rectangle. I don't know if I'm explaining this well. And then you do your increases for the sleeve that way, so it's basically looking like this.
It feels kind of like a raglan when you are working on it, but it just required a little bit more setup.
Yeah, I have never done a pattern like that before.
I think it's called contiguous, and I don't think I'd done it either. Contiguous.
Well, it is kind of similar to the April cardigan in that instead of... So, like in a normal raglan, you would be increasing on both the sleeve and the body versus, for instance, on the April cardigan, you're pretty much just doing your increases on the sleeve for at least a while. I think you do eventually go to a true raglan on that pattern, but I think it's very similar to that where you're really just doing your increases along the sleeve because you've already got your body set up. Did I do a good job explaining
eventually
that?
Eventually you do more increases on the body. Have you gotten there yet?
No, I don't think so.
Oh, okay.
But see, that's how the April cardigan is, too.
See, I have my figure.
But that one starts...
Maybe I need to.
It starts with a... Well, I never finished mine. I did not like the yarn I was using, but I did get through the yoke. I would like to go back to that pattern, but they start with more of a saddle shoulder, I guess, construction versus this one doesn't really have...
This one doesn't really have a saddle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just interesting. So, do you want to talk about the yarn you're using?
Oh, sure. I am using Scout by Kettleborn Woolens. And let's see if there's a color on here. I think it's chestnut. It's like a really deep brown. In some lights, it almost looks black, which I don't love. When I bought it in the store, I thought it was just like a really rich brown. And in most lights, that's what it is. But in some lights, it does turn black. So
I'm you can tell it's brown, though.
Yeah, I think so. In this light, you for sure can.
Hopefully on camera you can.
Yeah,
as we said that.
Yeah, it's just a wool DK base. It's really soft. I'm really liking it so far. And I went with this one instead of the recommended Pure Gint, only because Pure Gint also has a really, really dark brown that I was really leaning towards and I was almost buying, but then the yarn shop had this one in store too. And when I was holding them next to each other, the colors were super, super similar. Like it was hard to tell them apart. This one I think was a little bit cooler toned and the other one was a little warmer toned, which I did like. But this one was just softer and it was a little more economical price wise. So I went with this one. Do you want to talk about your yarn?
Yes. I have never used this company before. It is Pickles. I think it's their soft merino. It is super soft. Like I think this is softer than Double Sunday, which is, if you put this into yarn substitution, Double Sunday comes up as the most recommend, or like most
compatible.
Compatible. That's the word I was looking for. So, but I think it is softer than Double Sunday. Definitely softer than Knitting for Olives Merino. I love it. It's so cute. And we're doing this for a knit along with our friend Paige, who also knits. And me and Paige got pretty similar colors, even though I don't, I think she's using Barocco Ultra Alpaca for it.
I think so.
This was a pretty economical price too, I think, other than that the shipping kind of gets you. But I do have a story on this because I was like, what is wrong with me? And I think this like speaks to our like adjustment to algorithm, I guess is how I would say that.
Reliance on it.
Yeah, like my phone knows me. It knows that I'm a knitter. Like anytime a website's like, do you accept cookies? I'm like, yes, go for it. And so I remembered this color because she had said she wanted to do an olive color. And I was like, man, I hate to copy you, but that sounds so cute. I want an olive color too. And so I remembered seeing this yarn at one point and I was like, let me go find it. And I typed in Pickles to Google and I was like, why didn't yarn come up? And so I finally found it and ordered it. Well, I was just like, oh my gosh, I don't know.
Giving you like, is fermented cucumbers the right word?
Yeah, like it gave me I mean, I typed in Pickles. What was I expecting? Yeah. So I just had a good laugh at myself. I was like, okay, get it together. But now I have this color. It came in like a week and a half, so pretty fast. And yeah, that's what I'm using for mine.
Yeah.
So yeah, those are all I've got, other than I've got one acquisition.
I have one more whip and then one acquisition as well.
Okay.
Just kind of three acquisitions, sort of.
Oh, I know what you mean. Yes.
Yeah. In fact, I'll probably just talk about them together real quick.
Yeah.
This is, oh, it's super wrinkly from being in my knitting bag. This is the back of the Artisan. Oh, actually, I'm holding it upside down too because it's knit top down. This is the back of the Artisan cardigan by Sandus Garn, and it's part of their new DIY collection that they just released. I think it's the first one because they released two. And so I am using Double Sunday from Sandus Garn held together with their tinsel mohair, both in the colorway Almond. And if you've seen the cardigan, what really drew me to the pattern was that the back is all moss stitch, which is what I'm working on now. But then one side of the front has just like cables all down it. And then the other one has like a zigzag. Yes, actually.
Let me find it for you.
This was, it's not hard to find at all. This is, if it'll show, the cardigan that I'm working on. And actually, this is my acquisition that goes with it. Is I found a yarn, I think it's a yarn shop, maybe it was Yarn and Fabric. I don't know. There's a store in the UK that I found that sold copies of all the Sandus Garn booklets, which were really hard to get in the US. And they were actually cheaper over in the UK, but shipping was just astronomical. It cost as much to ship these as it did to buy the books. But because at the time when I ordered them, you couldn't get them in the US, I was like, I'll bite the bullet and pay for shipping. So I got the DIY volume one, and then its sister, the second volume, and then I got 2302, which I think was the last one prior to this. And when I found them online and I told Rachel I was going to order them, I was so excited because I was so proud of myself for finding them and like ordering them. And I knew I really wanted to make several sweaters out of these books, especially the Arctic Ursin cardigan, which I'm working on. Like that one, just as soon as I saw it, I was like, I have to make that. So I ordered it. And then a couple of days later, it occurred to me, I was like, I probably should have made sure that I ordered the English version. And so I went back to the website, and all of this text over here in the corner was all in Norwegian. I'm pretty sure it was Norwegian. So that was kind of a red flag. I was concerned. So I texted Rachel. I was like, I think I ordered these books in a language that I don't know.
Okay, but what I appreciate is that at no point were you like, I'm going to return it, or like, I'll give up. You were like, I'm going to figure this out. Yeah. Jessica's going to learn a whole nother language for this.
Well, I don't know if I was going to learn a whole nother language. I was going to learn enough to knit the patterns. Like, me and Google Translate were going to become best friends, was my plan. So I was really pleasantly surprised when it came in, and it is in English, so I can read it, and I don't need to be, like, Googling every single step.
Especially because I've heard that Santa's Garn is not, they don't hold your hand.
Oh, no, not at all.
Yeah, that's what I've not done a Santa's Garn pattern, but.
I've done one other Santa's Garn pattern. It was the Telemark 5010, so it's, like an all-over color-worked cardigan that you steep down the front. And no, they do not hold your hand at all. Like this artisan cardigan that I'm working on right now, it doesn't even tell you to like pick up stitches. I'm just going under the assumption that that's what I'm supposed to do. So if someone else has made this pattern, you know, correct me if I'm wrong on this, but it literally just says like for the sleeves, like knit this many stitches, but it doesn't tell you to cast on or what cast on to use or to pick up stitches or where to pick up those stitches. And then based on the charts, it looks like there's short rows within like the top shoulder shaping of each of the front cardigan panels, like those front sides, but it doesn't tell you how to do short rows, what type of short row to do, like anything like that. I'm just like looking at the chart and assuming that's what I'm meant to do because of the way that it's like shaped. But no, it does not hold your hand. So if you're one of those people that kind of likes things to be spelled out, I would not start with Santa's Garn. I would work your way up to it because it's pretty bare bones. And that was the way that my first cardigan that I knit from them was, because that one, it was like a bottom up, and then you connect the shoulders, but it didn't tell you like, oh, do a three needle bind off or use Kitchener stitch, or like even, it literally didn't even have instructions for like binding them together. I just assumed like, okay, well I need them to touch, so yeah, I'm gonna do something. And I think I probably did Kitchener stitch if I had to guess, but I don't know. I don't remember what I ended up doing, but I do remember like reading the pattern a lot because I was like, surely it says in here what to do. And I swear I read the pattern like 100 times and it didn't. You just kind of have to trust your gut and do what you think is going to be right.
I realized while we were talking and that I said that I have two whips. That's because in the last episode I also had two whips that were two different whips. And I have abandoned them. I will come back to them. But last episode I talked about my Margot top by Gregoria Fibers and my cardigan number 8 by My Favorite Things Knitwear. And I have not touched them since then. But I did buy new yarn. So we went to Oklahoma, like I said, to see some family. And while we were there, we actually went to Oklahoma City, but we stopped on our way to Tulsa and saw Knit Stars. And went in there. Knitty Natty, or Natalie from Knitty Natty, just did a tour of that place, which I think would be really worth watching because It was kind of hard to find.
It's a little hard to find.
But we found it.
We did. And I called the store and get instructions.
They were very nice.
Yes, they were super nice.
It's they do have some on the website, but I think we just got confused in person. It's like there's like a cute little courtyard that you have to walk through, and then it's like the third story in a building that's in the courtyard.
So you have to like find the entrance to the elevator.
Yes.
And then go up.
Oh my gosh, at one point we found this door and it had a code and we were like, oh no, it's locked. And then Jessica just like opens it and is like, no, it's not. So I don't think that's the door we were supposed to go into, but we found it. You
know,
so
we got there.
Yeah, we were determined. But anyway, it was a beautiful store. Just like, oh my gosh, so much yarn. It was a huge space. And so while I was there, I picked up the, I wanted to get like a Knitstar brand yarn just because it's, I don't know, it felt special, like something that you couldn't get anywhere else. So I got their Loops Luxe Plant-Based Princess, which is a cotton, bamboo, and hemp. I did get it in a nice boring beige, which is very true to us.
Very on brand.
Mm-hmm. And I don't have it. I got 5 skeins of this. I don't know for sure, but I think I might use this to join the Ranunculus Club because of all the years that I've been knitting, I have not knit that pattern yet. And if I did, I will probably hold it double so that it's a little bit thicker because this is a, I think it's either a fingering or a sport weight. It feels pretty light. So I picked up that as an acquisition. I will probably not cast it on until the next year because I want to finish up my Eva cardigan. I've got some more sock things that I want to knit, and then of course my Christmas sweater, and that'll probably take me through November at least. But I was just excited to have a Knitstars brand since we got to visit, so yeah. That was my acquisition.
I actually don't have any additional yarn purchases at the moment. One thing that I've learned about myself, because we've gone through to a couple of different yarn shops recently, and I think I'm the type of person that like I need to go in with a specific pattern in mind and then buy yarn just for that pattern, because I think I get overwhelmed when there's just so many options.
Yeah.
And I've kind of discovered like if I fall in love with a yarn and I don't have a pattern in mind, like for some reason my mind just will not come up with additional patterns. Like there's always like 100 things that I want to make, but as soon as I'm holding like a sport weight yarn, I'm like, I don't know a single sport weight pattern to save my life, you know. So I had a really fun time walking around and looking at all the yarn, but I kind of got overwhelmed. I didn't end up buying anything. And that's okay. It happens.
Honestly, it wasn't a bad trip, and I think we really enjoyed seeing family out there. I could probably see us going out there again. We actually do not have family that live in Oklahoma.
It's kind of the halfway point between us and some other family that we have down in Texas, so it worked out well to just meet there.
And we had some family fly in, and we just spent the weekend catching up, and so yeah, we might find ourselves there again. Yeah. So,
but yeah, I don't think we have anything else. Yeah. We'd love to hear what you're working on. We always love hearing what people are doing and how they're spending their time, and especially if you've made any of these patterns that we're working on or have finished objects, we'd love to hear how it turned out for you. So let us know.
And if you are coming back from Rhinebeck, we hope that you had a great trip and have safe travels. This will probably be up in a couple days, so hopefully you'll already be home from then. But yeah, just thank you for joining us.
Yeah.